Back in August, Gary and I received a request for an interview, and the request had a lot of questions, and the interviewer asked us just to answer the questions and send the answers back to him, and he would edit them and put them in the article. So to make it easier and save some time, we decided to record Gary's answers over the phone because we couldn't be in the studio at the same time together. He was in Florida and I was here in Atlanta. So I recorded his answers and transposed those for the article. The interview has not aired anywhere before. Nobody's heard it before. Wasn't intended to be released publicly, but I wanted to let you hear in Gary's own words his answers to some of the questions that we've been asked in this interview and others. Here in the first question, Gary has asked, how did your record deal with CBS come about?
We cut the record and we sent it out to a number of record companies who all turned it down, including CBS. But CBS said that they would keep an eye on it, and if anything happened, we were going to put it out ourselves, that they would be interested in hearing about it. So we put the record out in BGO Records, which was the first release they ever had. In a week, it sold 12,000 copies in Atlanta with just three plays. We called CBS back, and they called the radio station and the record stores and verified that this was a fact. Then they decided they wanted to take the record, so it switched over to CBS.
The next question was, how did you pick the games you wrote the songs about, and did you spend much time playing those games before you wrote the songs?
Yes, we went into the arcades. We had to cut the album in 3 weeks. We went into the arcades, and the ones that appeared that were both interesting games and been popular, and also ones that we thought we could write lyrics to go with. There were enough in the visual to complement the lyrics.
And the third question was, why did you decide to use sounds from the games in the songs, and how did you get those samples?
Well, actually, it was a natural to include the sound effects, being that we were doing a record. That's what we called it in those days. It was pretty much natural to work those in. We had an engineer that brought the recorder into the actual games, and we had people play the games, and we recorded the sound effects and then took them back into the studio and edited it.
The next question talked about the popularity of the games. They said there was a lot of excitement about video games back in those days. How popular were video games at that time?
They had been out for a while, but the actual video games as we know them were not that big. It was still switching over from pinball machines. In fact, when we first did the Pac-Man record, most of the record companies we sent it to weren't aware of what we were even talking about. So it was early on in the life of video games.
The next question was, what was the most memorable or unusual experience you had at the peak of the record's success?
That's an easy one. When we were waiting upstairs in the dressing room to go on American Bandstand show and watching the filming going on a monitor, Dick Clark knocked on the door and came into our office in an ABC sport sweatshirt on and came into our dressing room, and we were both speechless.
And the next question, we've read that you did a lot of appearances at arcades across the country. Did you perform there or just make an appearance?
Arcade experience was appearances only. We didn't play live.
And the last question asked, in retrospect, how do you feel about the Pac-Man Fever album?
I'm very happy with how it turned out, especially for the short time that we had to put it together. I think looking back on it that we did a great job of mixing the sound effects and the games with the songs that we thought were pop songs, and I'm very happy with it. I think it stands the test of time.